Hello friends, today on the Mentoria Career Tube channel, we have with us the very talented Chetna Vashisht, who is the founder and host at India's number one career talk show, Chit Chat. And she will be talking and sharing her life journey as a motivational career coach on YouTube.
So the journey has been, well, it's been a roller coaster ride. There have been highs, you know, working out of XLRI, getting into a corporate banking job in a multinational felt like a high. And honestly, I loved it for the first 10 years that I did it. Something in me perhaps was looking for a change, and I keep telling everybody the problem is me, I get bored very easily. So I just went up to IIM Bangalore one day and I said to them, you know, let's talk about placements and I need to, you know, we need to have Standard Chartered Bank, which is where I was. We need to be on your placement committee, etc., etc. And we got talking. And the head of the marketing department casually just said to me, he said, why don't you come in and conduct a course here on services marketing? And I said, you seriously mean it? Because I might just take up your offer. And he said, no, I seriously mean it. We're looking for somebody from industry and you've done this for a bit, so why don't you come over? And I took it up, but it was harder than I imagined it was at the start because, you know, with a full-time banking job on Saturdays and Sundays, I was taking these classes and sort of preparing and checking papers. And you've probably seen that IIM Bangalore auditorium in this movie called The Three Idiots. And I have to admit, it is overwhelming to be standing there with this staircase that goes right up and there's this tons of students sitting there looking at me like, who the hell are you? What makes you think that you can teach us? But anyway, from there, and the first time you go in there, you're obviously looking like this bacha who has no idea, and they ragged me enough, but I loved it. And something in me told me that this is something I really want to do. And very quickly, 3 months after that course got over, I quit my banking job and I taught for a couple of years at a lot of B schools, including IIPM, NMIMS, NITI, and a ton of others, and taught a lot of marketing courses. But one of the things that used to bother me at that stage was impact. You know, you've got 65 students in a room who sometimes go out of that room and forget what you told them. And I'm like, you know, what is the lasting impact I'm creating on anyone? Very soon you'll get down to checking papers and forget about lasting impact. But eventually I set up a training company and I said, let's work with banks because that's the domain I understand. So using my training expertise, I said to myself, okay, let me customize programs and work. So I worked with quite a few banks in the market, almost 10 or 15 banks. We did programs in India, we did programs overseas. And that was another great experience because there was a lot of learning for me as well. But like I said, I keep getting bored. And I so I wanted to move into, I was in education, I loved it, but again, that banking piece started making me feel, you know, I've got 30 people in the room who walk out of a training session saying, we've had a great session, but I'm not sure 2 days later whether they're implementing any of the things you've asked them to, or do they go right back into doing whatever they did before? And I questioned myself. I said, you know, what am I doing out here? I'm repeating myself. There is no lifetime value of what I'm talking today. And so then this idea about, let's put it all up on a channel where it stays for posterity. And YouTube is a great platform. You know, it sort of has billions of people logging in every single day looking for information. And if you have the right information, you get noticed. So that's where I put up all this information. It went down to students at the stage. I started doing college experience videos. So the first 20 videos on my channel are all about college experience at Harvard, at Cambridge, at Columbia, so on and so forth. And I love them because there were these young students talking about how much fun they had in freshman year and, you know, what kind of jackets they wear in the snow and all of that stuff. But soon we realized that India is a very, very large domestic market. And students going abroad is one part of the story. So then we moved on to Indian careers like law and medicine, etc. And then a couple of students came to me and said, you know, why only these traditional careers? You know, what about people who don't want to be a lawyer or a doctor or a chartered accountant? What do you have for us? So we did a video on scuba diving. I've got a video out there on how to become an RJ. There's singers. We did one with Terence Lewis on how to become a dancer, for instance. There's somebody wanting to do environmental biology and he tracks bats in a cave in South America, and we had his story up there as well. So the journey has been a whole lot of fun. I've met a ton of people with these beautiful, inspiring stories. And I hope you benefited from them because I loved every bit of the work that I did. Okay, at the age of 15, I actually wanted to become a doctor. And then I moved on from there and I did an undergrad in economics, and I imagined myself being the chief economist of India. At some point, I thought I'll be the CEO of a bank. And well, today I am what I am. So the idea was in general to create a platform where we could have students connect with, initially we thought, with senior students who are already at various colleges, already pursuing different careers, and if they could directly ask them questions and have those questions answered. So technology was a medium I was comfortable with because my husband runs an IT firm, and so that sort of background was there where I felt, okay, I can do something with technology. So the idea initially was to do a portal, but somehow I felt that, you know, I won't be able to control the responses that came in from the students, and will that be really something that'll become big, or will it just fizzle out? And then one day on a car journey in Bombay, and you know, in Bombay commute, you could be stuck in that car for a fairly long time. So the RJ was interviewing this YouTuber called Sherizad Shroff. And I think Sherizad doesn't know that she ended up inspiring me. But in that entire interview, she kept talking about how much fun she has as a YouTuber, and that she travels places and she shoots these videos and it's so exciting. And in that boring traffic jam, when I heard her, I said, this is what I'm going to do. I knew nothing about shooting videos, nothing about putting anything up on YouTube. I'd never even been on YouTube, you know, as trying to even upload a sort of sample video or anything before that. I had never made or edited a video at all. I hadn't even recorded stuff. I wasn't even like a camera person. So starting from there to now, it's been clearly a very long and hard journey. But sometimes you just take your life's decisions in a moment, in a car, stuck in traffic, and that's all right. I thought the three big skills that were demanded of somebody like me when I set off to start this YouTube channel were: one, technical; two, interpersonal; and three, organizational. And I'll explain them. So the technical skills that I needed, I didn't have. And there were three main technical skills: video recording, video editing, and social media and SEO skills. These three skills I didn't have. But the two other main skills, which today I feel were equally crucial in making this what it is today, is interpersonal skills, which includes skills of dealing with the person I'm interviewing, as well as dealing with the thousands of students that write in every day and interacting with them at various platforms. That somehow seemed like an innate skill to me. The third skill, which today is the most crucial skill for me, is organizational skill. Because posting a video every Friday means I need to find the right guest, do my homework, get the questions right, do the shoot, make sure the edit is right, the social media postings are done, and the videos uploaded on Friday. It calls for a lot of time management between the 7 days. I work literally morning to night, but it still needs a fair degree of organizational skills. I've got a small team with me, so managing them, getting everybody motivated. So broadly, three skills. I think technical skills you can keep acquiring. And to be very honest, you should keep acquiring, because technology is going to always keep changing. So be open-minded, pick up a new technology and work on it and keep going forward. I always encourage my students to write back to me, and I get these ton of messages where they tell me, why don't you do this, and why don't you do a study in Korea, and why don't you do the cost of studying in Japan, and so on and so forth. So the moment I get a lot of requests for a particular topic, that's what I start thinking about, saying, hey, you know, five different people have told me this, why don't I think about it? And in YouTube, we also have this community tab where every time I've got these five or six topics that I'm tossing between, saying, you know, should we do this or that, I go into the community tab and I put up a poll question there, and I put all those five options, and they come back to me and tell me, you know, this is what you need to do first and this is what you can do later, and I just follow them and the results come for themselves. So if 3.5 years ago you had asked me, do I see this channel looking the way it is today, I would have said clearly no. And right now, if you ask me, do you know which direction you're headed in going forward, then clearly I don't have an answer to that. But I go with each day and I make sure each single video. So let's assume that there is a goal to become the number one YouTuber. I think that goal sometimes becomes too far-fetched. But if you break that up into salami slices and you look at just that next video that you're going to put up on Friday, and you make sure that that next video is what the students asked for, I think you'll be well on your way to becoming whatever you're meant to become. As far as the bigger piece on the whole channel is concerned, you try to space out content in such a manner which matches the students' timeline. So for example, October, November is typically the time when they start planning to apply to colleges abroad. So starting September, you want to put in a lot of videos that talk to them in that field about studying abroad, applying abroad, how to write your statement of purpose and all of that. Closer to November, December, they're choosing between colleges, or in fact towards January, they've got their results and they're choosing between colleges. So that's a good time to give them college experiences at various colleges to help them decide which college is more suitable to them. Also, there are times when there is, for example, the NEET exam is at a particular time, the JEE exam is at a particular time, the UPSC exam is at a particular time. So we've got these slots in the year where we know that there's action at a certain end. And we pick up that particular piece more during that period. Sort of, if I look at it with a helicopter vision, that's what I would do. I would plan my 12 months. There's also a lull period. Around February, March is when most students are told, switch off YouTube, get into your exams and study for your exams. And that's when all of us who are talking to students face that lull. But then you tide over it. You try to put up motivational videos at that time. You try to give them tips on how to study for your board exams. You try to get toppers on people who've done that exam in the past, giving them last minute tips of, you know, what to do, what strategies to adopt during the exam, and so on and so forth. So broadly, that's how I plan the calendar. Do I know always a month in advance what I'm going to be putting up a month later? Sometimes I've had shoots where I've told the person, I'm sorry, your interview is only going to be released 3 months later because we've got so much content right now. And there are some times when I shoot and I release immediately the next Friday. But if you have to do a video every single Friday, you can't always have 3 months of content. And so sometimes it's there and sometimes it's not there. But yeah, broadly, that's how I plan the whole year. Okay, so now I think I'm lucky to have a tiny little team with me. But I think you would guess that when you start something like this at the beginning, you can't afford to have a team at all. So tasks like video editing, SEO, postings, and even contacting prospective interviewees and scheduling and every single thing you're doing on your own. So the first 100 videos I decided I will edit on my own because, like I said, I didn't have the technical knowledge and I wanted to know exactly what I'm doing before I delegate it away to somebody else. So I would do my own SEO, my own social media posting and my own editing. Eventually you realize that, you know, you get stuck with a lot of tasks which become repetitive. And every week you're spending 2 to 3 days just editing videos. So you discover that, okay, I've probably done a fair bit of learning on this end and I'm happy to give away this baby to somebody else and move on to something else, which could then become the core of this company. And that's perhaps the only way to keep going up the value chain, so to speak, use a cliched word. So video editing I gave away to a very young and enthusiastic boy who sometimes comes in even and does my camera work. What do I look for in people when I hire them? And the number one, two and three qualities are person being a great human being. I know you may sound like, why is it one, two and three? But for me, it is one, two and three. The ability to edit a movie only comes in at four. Because the one, two and three will take care of desire to learn, will take care of ethos matching. And so coming to four and five, to me, the other thing that matters is punctuality. I also have a team that helps me with SEO. And when it comes to that end, again, I've done it for a few years and decided, for that skill, I need initiative. I want the person to come back to me and says, hey, you know, why don't we design the thumbnail like this? And why don't we approach this new platform? Because I want my eye completely off SEO right now. I want to focus on research, on content, and on how can we build this into a, you know, better content. I don't want to be focusing so much on the social media. How do we tag? How do we post? So the skills that I look for on the SEO end are clearly initiative, drive, and self-motivation. I also have somebody in the office who helps me with my work, and she's this really sweet person. So like I said, the person matters to me a lot. Syncing with me, and all three of the people that work with me are sometimes more passionate about Chet Chat than I am. And when I lose motivation and I say, hey, you know, nothing's working and we need to change, and they come back and say, no, we've got a fantastic channel, we're going to keep going, and I don't know why you're feeling demotivated, because we love the work you're doing. So yeah, being motivated and loving the work is super key for me. First of all, YouTube is an extremely difficult platform to make money on. So if you're looking at it as becoming a YouTuber for the sake of making money, then think really hard before you get into it. It takes a ton of work and a whole lot of, I mean, to use the cliched word, passion. And the reason I say passion is because when the chips are down, you still want to keep going. It takes a lot of that to actually reach a stage where you start getting that credit into your account every single month. However, looking at this as being a motivational speaker, as being a career coach, and the YouTube platform and the subscriber base that you develop, you build on this eventually after the first couple of years, and then you can make revenue. So typically what happens is, the way to look at it is, you look at your subscriber base as your customers. And if you can find the appropriate set of products or services to market to these customers, that's where you'll start making money. Now, what those appropriate services are, what those appropriate products are, we need to be sure that that's in sync with A, our line of work, and B, it's something that the customer really wants. Because if I start throwing products at the customer which he doesn't want, they're going to unsubscribe to my channel. So typically, I would use offline career counseling perhaps to supplement the work that I'm doing. I would write books, which is what I'm doing right now, on the topics that I'm covering right now, and give them to my target audience to buy from me, supplementing this entire range of information that I'm already giving to them. Of course, there's always sponsored videos and affiliate marketing that you can do, but I would caution you to be very careful about putting a ton of sponsored videos in front of your customers, because they can sense. See, the key thing always is, like I said, the customer. So if the information that you're giving them is clearly authentic and they can see that, they keep coming back to you. So keep sponsorships a little low-key. Don't make that the main source of revenue. Another thing I'm working on right now, it may be too early to talk about, is storytelling, and trying to see how we can build some sort of fictional stories around students and use the platform again to share them with you. So there's a lot of things you can do. You need to be A, creative, and B, always remain true to your core and don't digress from there, so your customers stay with you for the long term. The beauty of this job is that there is no typical work day. You're sort of doing every single thing every day. There is no Sunday, there is no Saturday, there is no morning or evening. So I typically start working. I get up in the morning and I do a little bit of riyaz, basically to keep my voice in shape for the kind of work that I do. And I start working at 8. And I sometimes sleep at 11 or 12 in the night, and my computer is always open. I'm always going back to my table, and I just take breaks maybe to do the things that I need to do, take Simbi down to play, that's my little pup, or take time out with family for an hour or two. I don't watch TV, there are no shows right now that I'm following. So it's a lot of work, but it's a lot of fun. So I also devote a couple of hours every day to ensure that I respond to every viewer question that has come into me, whether it's come in on my email, on YouTube, on Instagram, on Twitter, on Facebook. I try to get back to them, each one of them, with their piece of information. If they're asking me for, you know, which is the best college that I can go to in Canada for architecture, then I'll do a quick research and try to go back with some website links and say, hey, why don't you take a look at this link? And all of that takes up a couple of hours in a day, but that is the most important part of my day, where I talk to my viewers and I keep in touch with them. It's hard work, it's fun, and it's a little rewarding in the beginning. Hopefully it gets better at the end, but all in all, it's deeply satisfying. You know, the World Economic Forum recently made a statement that 65% of children entering primary school today will end up working in careers that do not yet exist. So if you're in your 8th standard or 9th standard, don't worry. You don't need to have all the answers right now. In fact, you cannot have all the answers right now. So do what you're good at, do what you like, build skills. So if you build a whole stack of skills, and have you watched this cartoon called Dilbert? And the founder of that cartoon called Scott Adams made this statement saying, you can never be great at any one thing. And you can in fact never know what skill is going to be required in the future for what job. But if you have a whole talent stack, then you could be unique in your own way, because that stack is something that you have. For example, Walt Disney. He was a cartoonist growing up, but looking at a cartoonist becoming the biggest amusement park owner doesn't seem like a natural extension to you. So as a kid, if you're a cartoonist, become a great cartoonist, because tomorrow you could be distributing newspapers, and then you get into newspaper cartooning, and you could have a friend, and here I'm talking about Walt Disney, you could have a friend who's into the world of theater, and you pick up that skill, and then you start making movies, and then you find a business partner who says, hey, why don't we set up an amusement park? And you could be the owner of the biggest amusement park. But if you ask Walt Disney when he was 6, did you envisage that you're going to be the owner of the biggest amusement park business in the world? I think he would have laughed at you, saying, what is that in the first place? So when you're 13 and when you're 14, don't worry about the future. Worry about the present. Make sure every single day you're learning something new or improving on whatever you already have. And if you're doing that every day, you're going to end up in a beautiful, great, successful place. So Anirudh, thank you for inviting me. And for all of you, if you want to watch my channel, the link is given in the description box under the video. And you can also follow me at Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook at chetchat101.
And for more such interesting content, don't forget to subscribe to the Mentoria CareerTube channel on YouTube.